In this video, Rick's going to install the Schneider Easy9 compact multi-row consumer unit. I pose the question to you, are the current consumer units we're fitting big enough for installations that in the future will become prosumers, where we have battery, solar and EV? We've all done it, we're on the continent, we're on holiday and we're poking around in their consumer unit to find different types of overcurrent protection device, time clocks and contactors. And is that the way we're going in the UK? In the configuration we've got here on the bottom row, we've got a Type 2 SPD, main switch and RCBOs. And on the top row, we've got AFDDs. Well, I've fitted loads of consumer units before. So the one that was fitted on the wall here was fitted by Rick. So let's see how he did it. First for me then, Rick, I'm going to be the first time I've watched anyone install an Easy9 compact multi-row consumer unit. So what are you going to start off with?
Yeah, I'm just going to take out a couple of these knockouts at the back. So I've got one here and one there.
So. Okay, so those cables can come through.
Yeah,
it's going to give us plenty of room in it when we're working with it. And it's usually the thing we all say, there's not enough room in our consumer unit in order to dress our cables. We've got plenty of room this time. So knock out that one. Oh, look. Pretty fancy.
That's that one, and I've got another one here.
Okay.
Just try and hit it near the spot welds.
Okay, that broke nicely. Okay, I'll take it we're in for a little bit of grommet strip now to protect those. Let's just see what other people do, whether they use super glue or think of another way in order to hold it into place. Always use super glue. So check this one for length. See if it fits. There we go. Oh, that's a nice tight fit, isn't it?
Yeah,
two at that length should be perfect. Always find when I use super glue, I put it everywhere I don't need it, normally on my hands, and find that they're stuck to everything, and then the item I'm trying to stick down hasn't got enough glue on it. But you look a dab hand at that. Is that years of doing Airfix models in your youth, Rick?
Not quite, no. It's fixing Josh's toys.
Okay, that's your son's toys, right. Little dobs of glue. That's another little top tip. I probably put too much glue on. Probably went a bit mad when I used to do it. Remember, there are other glues available, not just super glue. So we pop that one in there. And we get that protection. And we do both, and we can mount it on the wall. How's that looking? Oh, a little bit of random stickiness. Look at that. Yeah, perfect. Just pop it onto the surface there. I'd like to tell you that I've added up the number of entry points on the outside, Rick, to be 18, and there's 8 in the back, so you have plenty of holes to choose from.
Yep.
And now you're ready to obviously make that final securing of the fixings. Then we can start dressing the cables. So within this multi-row, we're going to use the top one to house the AFDDs, and I'm always interested in how people identify their cables coming into a board. So what have you done this time, Rick?
Yeah, we've got two ring circuits here. So to identify them, I've got two nicks here for them ones and a single nick on this one here.
Okay, slightly larger cable. You also put a nick in. That doesn't seem as if that was worth doing.
Yeah, well, I've actually got another one here, Gaz, which is for the cooker circuit. So if you have a look on this one, there's no nicks. So that clearly identifies which is which.
Okay, and as that's going into the AFDD, you've got it in the correct section at the top there. That's logical.
Yep.
So you strip your cables ready to make your connections. Which ones are you going to start with connecting?
Yeah, so I'm going to make off the CPCs. Once I've got the sleeving on, I'm going to dress them along the top and then connect them into the board.
And as it's the AFDDs on the top, they've got quite a cute way of which we pick up the line and neutral for these as well, haven't they?
They have, yes.
Made a lovely job with those CPCs. What's next?
Yeah, I'm going to remove this DIN rail, so when I'm dressing in the line of neutrals for each circuit, it's close to the board and I'm not having to fight to stuff them behind.
Oh, right, that makes it a lot easier. Are you going to try and sort of guess the position of them as well, so as you dress them into where you think the AFDDs are going to sit?
Yeah, exactly, yeah, so I just put them in a position I feel the AFDDs are going to be.
Well, they're not AFDDs, what are they, Rick?
No, they're terminal blocks of them, so we've got the line of neutral, which will connect us to the bottom row. But what we've also got on this DIN rail is two little nicks here, so as I slide these across, it butts them up and it allows me to pop the lid on much easier.
Just making those final connections on the third of the AFDDs. Are you going to torque them up at this stage?
No, I'll torque them up at the end so I can go through it methodically.
Okay, I'm sure everyone else has noticed RCBOs have a fly lead to the neutral bar, but these AFDDs don't, so how are they picking up their neutral?
We take a look at this bus bar, it clearly identifies neutral and line. So as we flip this over and pop it into the terminal block here, we need to make sure we're getting the correct polarity.
And that's from this end here, isn't it? So it goes neutral, then line, and we'll put the tails in that links the bottom section to this one later on. But I can see some copper exposed on the end here. Are we leaving it like that?
No, we've got some caps that we can use to cover them up. as we go along.
Okay, and it seemed to go with real ease there into the top of the AFDD. Is there anything that can help the electrician?
Yes, if you want to take a look at the top of this AFDD here, as I tighten that up or close the cage, you can see the no miss technology.
So let's remind ourselves of the protection an AFDD will offer us. It'll offer us the technology from an MCB, so it'll offer short circuit and overcurrent protection. It's also an A-type RCD, rated at 30 milliamps, so we'll offer additional protection, as well as protection against serial and parallel arcs. And we know in certain instances in BS7671, these are mandated on socket outlets, single phase up to 32 amps. But in a domestic dwelling, it is recommended in those locations. Recommended means you should install them. And as we move forward, we will see more and more use of AFDDs. I'll turn me back for a minute and you're already making off the last connection into our RCBO. And talking of connections, I can see we've got connections in the bottom of the main switch, the surge, neutral bar and up to the terminals at the top where we pick up our AFDDs. And we've left a link in the description for a separate video on how we made those connections. And talking about connections, do I have to have that surge and main switch on the left hand side, Rick?
No, the SPD and main switch can both go to the other side.
Okay, we've configured it RCBO AFDDs. Is there any other way we can have it?
We could have a full AFDD board should we want to. We can also have MCBs and RCBOs on both bottom and top.
You could say the Easy9 compact multi-row consumer unit has got you covered for all situations. Okay, so you had plenty of holes to choose from. So we're putting our glands and a buzz bar in next before we do the lid.
Yep, let's just take that off there.
That one into position. Okay, that's the advantage, isn't it? That many holes, that many positions you could have come in to. So see, you got your towels in, now it's the bus bar to go in, and then we're just going to concentrate on that lid. You say you talk up at the very end, so you're still just nipping these in, yes?
Yeah, just getting things into place.
And then we'll go around and talk them up afterwards. Hold on, Rick, you got the old inch and a half eights out in order to hold the consumer unit cover, and I've seen it many times before on domestic consumer units.
Well, I think I'm going to opt for the metric captive screw.
Okay, so let's pop those on then. I do love a captive screw, especially on a consumer unit cover. There's nothing worse, is there? Whenever you take it off, it drops and goes left, you look right, you can never find it, can you? Wow, that was one of those eFix videos that gave you plenty of opportunity to comment. However, at the start of the video, I mentioned the word prosumer, and you might have spent the last 7 minutes going, I'm not sure what a prosumer is. And if that's the case, check out the video over there.